Hello and welcome to Q&A NY number 8, live from Reto.Moto headquarters in Copenhagen. I'm Reto.Gargamel, a tea-drinking necromancer, and with me is the game director, Reto.RedBjarne.
Hello.
And, well, I'll put this down. It's too hot anyway. last week we had the Reto Insider Summit. Oh, this is the news, by the way. We already had Reto Circinus that talked about it in his community frontline number 6 last Wednesday. You can find it on YouTube. There's also a report about what happened at the summit on the way. More on that later. And well, many insiders have already shared what they've experienced here on the forums. So you can go check the forums and you'll see what they had to say about it. If you look at our news page, I guess you can full screen, we have two things. You have on the right side here a letter from the CEO, if you want to read that. It just came out yesterday. And we are doing today, we're opening a prototype, the prototype server for a new public test of the upcoming 1.10 update. And you can, I think, right away go and try it out. I think I'm just going to check the... you can see what time it starts and everything over here. I think it's already open, isn't it?
I don't know.
I'm trying, actually. I just got the confirmation that it was open, so... I think it must say it somewhere, actually. Sorry. I don't have the exact time at which it starts, but I think it's already open. And so you can find in this forum post basically what we're testing and why, and the proper channel if you want to give feedback. There's a forum thread just for that. So that will be also open, I guess, soon. And so the idea with feedback is there's one thread where you can put all your comments, and if you want to link to some other content, you can put a link in your post in that thread. And then so basically all the information will be in one place for the developers to look at. So please don't, if you see something that's wrong in prototype, don't send a support ticket to me. Don't go to the forum thread, because we want really all the feedback in one place. Otherwise, we are. There's also a link in this article somewhere to the changelog.
There you go.
This is where you will find a description of what's new in 1.10. I think it's a kind of bare bones description. It probably does not necessarily have all the details, but you can see that we added. Look at that, helmet covers.
A ton of them.
A ton of helmet covers. So yeah. You get to fine tune your equipment.
I think basically we just took all the different uniform color schemes and just made a helmet cover for each one of them, so you can get a helmet for your uniform.
More camo. Never enough camo. That's awesome. Yeah. We got a nice candy. A gift.
Oh, yeah.
A nice.
That's only a fraction of it. It was like a huge box.
The rest was consumed.
Huge packed box from?
From a gentleman called Mick Life, a member of Clan TAW, the Art of Warfare.
Warfare.
And he's on Twitch TV also. You can go see him on his Twitch channel. It's Mickey_Civ, as in civilization, I guess, mm-hmm. _Div, as in. Divide. So Mickey_Civ_Div. I guess the link will be show up someplace. And later on, basically, what we're going to do the rest of this stream is answer forum questions. We had a new record of 171 questions. I'm afraid we're not gonna go through 171 today.
We should do a marathon at one time.
We will speak as fast as possible.
See how long it takes to go through questions in one session.
We'll like have a tongue injuries.
We can pre-record and just like broadcast it as it would be live. Fake it.
So this is the questions. These are the questions.
Oh my God.
Where's my I think this was full screen. No, this is not full screen. Where's the menu thing? Ah, there it is. View full screen. There's no shortcut for full screen. That's kind of lame. Anywho. F11. Yeah, F11. But there's like two full screens.
Oh, yeah.
Whatever. The questions. And you can see like the number of votes is... whoops. Actually had a little comment where, what's up with the numbers, because the number of votes was super high. We had a lot of people really posting questions and voting on them. I think it's because we're linking directly to the thread now.
It sort of like paid off to get the links from the front end into the to the.
So without further ado, first question is from
just
from
a second. Just a second. I think I need to.
You need to.
I need to demonstrate grab myself a tootsie roll here. Yeah. Yeah.
My first question is
What? A quick.
Can be approved.
Switch. Mm-hmm. Oh. Mm. Tootsie roll. Mm.
Elegantly chewing. Oh. Mm. G dog. when you're ready. G-Dog78 is asking, will squad communication ever get some new features? As an example I used before, if we hold the F key, we will get the ability to tell the squad things like enemy spotted, I need a medic, that kind of stuff, enemy armor spotted, low on ammo, etc. It would add better communication between players. Mm-hmm. Also, I think it would be great to hear this as audio. I need a medic!
Yeah,
since
definitely.
Currently we are basically silent, and that would also allow to be allow you to be heard by enemies like whistling. And he has one more recommendation. Have a cooldown period to prevent spam.
I think, I actually think that's why these kind of things are difficult to... Yeah. Because, yeah, people would spam it. I need a medic, and but if they don't need a medic, that, then they can actually fake it. And that's also sorts of crazy things that can happen when you have full control of what you want to say. But I think a lot of them actually make sense. But I think we have discussed this a few times, and we would rather like to see communication based on context. Rather than you just getting a list of things you can say, so the enemy spotted could actually be incorporated into the spotting mechanism. When you instead of the bling, let's say having an enemy spotted thing, rather than you just spamming enemy spotted if you haven't seen an enemy.
So you just say it.
Yeah,
that's my.
Or you could say that when you reach a certain amount of health, you will automatically say medic or something like that. So it gets more contextual rather than you have to make the actual choice to do it. Because such a menu can easily get overwhelming, because then you just start to pile in all sorts of different things you would put in. So it's a great question. I think we will probably try and update the current context sensitive menu in rather than having it just a list of stuff you can say.
Okie dokie.
Simply because then the game is a little bit more in control of what's being said. It fits the situation better than just players having the ability to spam stuff.
Yeah, and say something that has nothing to do with.
Yeah.
I've noticed that people are whistling a lot after killing you. Instead of whistling to friends, they whistle to enemies, like, haha, I got you.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think, I don't know, it's a cultural thing. In some cultures, whistling is offensive. I think there's something to do with that.
It's just because that's the only thing they can say.
You know, or that, yeah. But, so, next question is...
Remember, they just killed someone and say, I need a medic! Just to...
Sarcastically.
There's a great room for sarcasm here.
Yeah.
So,
Carotte, 100, is 100. Asking, will driving over rails be made smoother? Now it stops your vehicle almost completely.
Oh, I hope so. I hope so. It's one of the things that obviously the rail system is sort of like just placed via some automated system, and some places the bumps are too high. That needs to be some. There are some areas where it just gets super hard to cross, and we should obviously take a look at those areas actually together with the vehicle update, with the smoother terrain and everything. So yes, it's more like something that requires a little bit more time to get the tweaks right, rather than it's not a it hasn't been a conscious decision that, oh, it should be super hard to drive over the rails. It's more like it's just hard to get it to get it to be not super hard. Mm. So we'll look into that, definitely.
Okie dokie. I have to stop saying okie dokie, sorry. I'm going to start sounding like Ned Flanders or something. Lone Wolf Spy is asking, since bipods are on the back burner, can we have a system to rest our weapons on cover and become more steady while aiming?
But that is...
That is the bipod system. That is the problem,
so
right?
Yeah. Kinda, is you can have that system when it comes out of... when it comes back down from the shelf. Mm. But that's actually how the bipod system works, that it rests every weapon on.
And that's what is presently not yet working perfectly.
It is working, but it just has so many flaws, weird situations you could get into, animations that do strange things, and that we haven't solved all the problems with it yet. Mm. So that's the answer for that.
Right.
Yep.
Taurus the Bull 77 is asking. I refuse to think that there's 76 Taurus the Bull. Sorry.
But Taurus isn't that? Isn't it Greek for bull?
It's Latin for bull.
Latin. Yeah.
Yeah. What regions do you plan to explore in the strategy game?
Bull.
Are you listening?
No.
What regions do you plan to explore in the strategy game? Right now, there's just Europe. Could Africa possibly come into play?
Oh yeah, definitely.
I mean, you drew it on the map.
Yeah. I think obviously, yeah. The ambition is obviously to add all the different theaters to the map. So Africa could definitely come into play. Mm-hmm. The thing that is. That would take us a little bit more time to do with the adding the sort of like an Africa map. It wouldn't take us a long time to actually do a yellow sand map, if that's the question. It's the fact that all vehicles would need like a desert type camo, and we would probably have to have some sort of a system that could automatically switch to that camo scheme when you are in the desert. So you don't end up with a
handicap.
A forest camouflage in the middle of the desert that might not be too good. But
unless you want to, right? Unless you absolutely like that one.
But that's just us deciding on what kind of system do we want? Because I think obviously all the vehicles should have a desert camo from the get go for a map like that. The second thing is, we get back to all the uniforms. You would probably need to have some sort of a whole new uniform for all the soldiers, in with like t-shirts and short-legged pants and stuff like that. Simply because, that's actually a much bigger task, excluding the pilots, because I think those are sort of expected to have that kind of clothing on. I don't think they had a special desert uniform.
I have to watch The English Patient again, but really, no, I don't want to watch The English Patient.
At least
again.
A flying uniform that was different when they flew over a desert. I think it would, in those heights, it would be the same cold weather anyway.
Yeah, I guess.
But the other soldiers would need to have a sort of like a summer uniform type thing that fits the desert theme. And I think that's actually the biggest challenge of making a desert map is that it everything else has to be desert too. So I think that's at least it's not that we don't want to do the Africa thing, but I think the stuff we're doing now with the Russian terrain is just much easier because it's a terrain that fits the current set of content.
Next one, Sniper 172002 is asking, any future new vehicles such as tanks, car, planes, etc.?
Yeah, a lot. Actually, we have deliberately held back lots of new vehicles because it seems that we get a lot of negative feedback when just releasing the vehicles instead of basic game mechanic updates and new maps and stuff. So we're focusing on the other things like the new maps, for example. And we also have some internal pipeline stuff we need to go through. Our technology needs an update, which is kind of boring to talk about, but we do need to upgrade certain areas of the tech once in a while. Game mechanics, as you probably already know, we are hard at work updating all the vehicles with all the different things that they that you can do with the vehicle. So instead of just releasing more vehicles on and weapons, we just sort of like decided to hold those back and focus on the other things.
Yeah, you mentioned last time, I think that the question also came up last time, and it basically was, you said instead of you would have to adjust them for the current system, then readjust them again.
Yeah, that's actually one of the reasons, but also it's more like the whole just us releasing a few new planes would be somewhat perceived as negative, simply because people think, why don't you work on the maps? Mm-hmm. But we do work on the maps, but simply just releasing it's different guys who does the vehicles than the guys who does the maps, so it doesn't interfere. But we think, just to not confuse players too much, we hold them back, and then we'll sometime next year make a huge update to the vehicles.
So, right.
Is that a good and very long answer for a very short question?
Cowman, well, how do you say that? Cowman 1800 is asking, could the XP needed for some ribbons be reduced, or could you give more ribbon XP for certain actions? Grinding some of the ribbons takes far too long, and it often is quite tedious. The driver and chauffeur ribbons are two of the worst examples of this, as they involve a lot of not actively fighting in combat to get such a small amount of ribbon XP. Surely, hope you're not talking about driving off into the forest to drive around
yeah,
circles.
Some of them need a little tweak or two, but I think that what we also need to do is take a look at our ribbon boosters at some point to see if some of them can be done better, given bigger boosts and stuff like that, so it gives greater value. Mm. We haven't really the booster system can do all sorts of things, where it can boost more, or it can work in a longer period and stuff like that. So we haven't really dug into that area of the game's mechanics yet, and that could be a thing that could be useful as well. So.
Yes, ODST515 is asking, will you ever implement an engineer class? It would allow infantry to focus on direct combat, and the engineers would instead carry explosives and slow the movement of tanks, build defenses for allies, etc.
That's a lot of things that the engineer should do. I don't think we will add a specific engineer class, though, but we have been talking a lot about specializations, so you can specialize an engineer, or like in this case, you would specialize an infantry soldier to become an engineer, and you can give him certain advantages that include some explosives and extra things he can do. So that's kind of like the direction we would probably take. So we could say like the engineer can carry a lot more explosives than a normal infantryman, for example. Mm. But then he would, what we talked about is that we adjust the equipment points for certain weapons and certain weapon classes. So you say like the engineer might have, the explosives might take a lot fewer equipment points, and the regular weapons will take more. So he can have a lot more explosives than regular weapons, and so that would be one way to a very simple way to create an engineer class. Mm-hmm. But it's you can say like build defenses for his friends. That's a more complicated thing, because that requires a.
Dynamic.
That's a very, very complex system to make something where you can build stuff in the game. Unless it's something pre-made, you just push a button and it builds like a wall that we put in. If you want to have a total freedom type system, it's a different story.
I've seen that somewhere in a game that won't be named. Where it's like one place you get to do it and that's it.
So it would be more like a push the button kind of mechanic rather than I can build a wall or I can build defenses anywhere.
Yeah. So I guess that's all for engineers now.
But it could be like many years ago when we were first testing the different maps. We had the metal bridge in the town map, used to be we used to have a game mode where you can blow the bridge up by placing explosives on it, and it was like just blow the whole thing apart. It was us testing to see if the map could have several game modes on the same map type. But you could say if we were to bring back stuff like that, it could be a special function that only engineer type infantry could do, for example. But then again, if the game mode is about blowing up the bridge, it would be super uncool to spawn into a map where your
characters can complete the mission.
Yeah. So.
Right, moving on then. Eternal Robot is asking, what vehicles are currently completed for Armor 2.0? If so, may we have a showcase?
It's hard to say what is completed because we're working on different areas in parallel. Some of them are more finished than others. I think the medium tanks has been adjusted for the terrain update, if I'm not mistaken.
The medium
tanks.
Okay.
I think.
Have been adjusted.
Adjusted. So.
He's talking about vehicles being completed. Yeah. I don't know what that.
No. Yeah, that he probably would refer to all the new armor stuff and the internal hitboxes and.
So what we already
new sites and new sites and new and the terrain physics and everything. So there's no. To my knowledge, there's none of those that are actually completely finished. Mm-hmm. Some of them have internal hitboxes, but haven't been adjusted for the physics yet, and vice versa.
All right. So not yet.
Basically, yeah, it's all over. Half finished stuff all over.
All right. Well, the follow-up questions is really from
what?
Pretiriar? Yeah, Pretiriar Sangstar is asking what will happen in the 2.0 update, and here we assume this is the vehicle update we're talking about.
Yeah, it's a bit annoying to call it the Armor 2.0 or 2.0 because it's sort of like it has a bunch of minor details, and then there's some revamping or some improvement on existing systems and stuff. So I wouldn't really call it 2.0. I just call it updates on various areas of the vehicle code. Currently our goal is to have the new penetration system in the update with the internal hitboxes. We will have the physics with the terrain is now acting differently. Your bicycle would not be very good on a field. It would be probably a lot better riding it along the ways or along the roads. Mm-hmm. What else do we have? We have the deploy system that's also part of this this update. It might come earlier, but it's the new stuff. The new updates will require a lot of retweaking of the vehicles, simply because they have changed so much. And the deploy system is somewhat, it has some tweaks in it as well. We're taking all the timers and taking all the current deploy timers and put them into a system that's more dependent on on what you're actually using. And that also requires a lot of retweak because some of the tanks or some of the vehicles might actually change characteristics so much that they suddenly become very useful or not as usual as before, stuff like that. So it's hard to say. But that's the current things we're definitely working for. There's a few other minor things like the penetration range being implemented finally. So shots on a long distance have a degraded penetration, and we are also doing some small updates to the high explosive rounds. Let's say they become. When you shoot at long distances, they become much more inaccurate. So shelling from a long distance will be much harder, much more.
So you're not sniping so much with a tank; you're more suppressing.
Yeah, right? I think was that all? Did I remember everything?
So you mentioned just for clarification, you're saying you might release the new deploy system in advance.
Maybe, I don't know. It's probably not. It's In the beginning, when we talked about it, we talked a lot about if it was possible to release each of these areas separately, but they interlink so much that it's probably not really possible.
One without the other would kind of feel unbalanced, is what you're saying.
Would just require us to rebalance the stuff once again. And having one set of vehicles on the live service with one set of tweaks, then we can't really tweak those because we know that in the next update everything has to be retweaked again. So it would kind of like if something was badly tweaked from the get-go, then we wouldn't really have the option to tweak it, because then we would spend a lot of time tweaking something that would be replaced afterwards. So I know it's a bit hard to understand or to explain, but it's a lot of parameters that goes into setting up a vehicle, and it's a lot of especially when we're talking the physics stuff. There's a lot of stuff that works together. It's hard to sort of like just transfer one from the other. So I think we might just release everything at once, and then just be prepared for several months of tweaking on live while we sort of like collect data from how are the players actually using the new system. So
changes ahead. What's the next one? It's J. Taricio is asking, can you add bots to the empty seats of planes and tanks? For example, add bots to the machine gunner position in a tank, or to give a better progression support. To the tankers, or add bots to the rear seats of some planes. These seats are usually empty, but he says these seats usually don't have a very fun factor, so people usually don't like riding them, even though they're useful.
That's actually a topic that has been discussed a lot in here, and I think it's definitely worth exploring that possibility, because some of the vehicles have extra seats that are, as he says, not super fun to play, but are useful if you're actually using them, like the rear guns on some of the Russian tanks, for example, are very useful. The bow machine gun is also useful if you sort of like know how to position your tank correctly, so it actually covers part of the stuff that you're not covering with the turret. So definitely something we're discussing. It's not on the release list just yet, but it has been discussed, and I think it's worth digging a little bit more into it, because it's another upgrade for your tank or your vehicle.
Does it? I think I asked that like last time. The bots without a body, would that take as much?
Bots without a body.
What I'm saying, like, if it's just somebody manning, if it's a bot being inside the vehicle, just manning the machine gun,
like a sentry type thing.
So basically, does it require a lot of resources? I mean, it's an AI looking for stuff, right?
I think we already have our internal testing bots. It's possible to man the extra seats, I think.
Okay, so that's a possibility. But I've never seen it. Cool. I'm gonna look for it. I'm gonna look for that if it's there. A lot of people are asking, and so we combine the question. That's a popular question. Eventually, when a fourth faction is added, which nation will it be? Will it be Denmark, Finland, or Great Britain? That's very specific.
Yeah.
What about the Italy?
Well, currently, we have the option to either make one nation with a lot of stuff, or maybe like three new nations that only have, for example, one character class, one vehicle, one weapon, type thing. So it really is kind of undecided. But I think, or I know that we would most likely pick some of the bigger countries that actually have a lot of unique stuff, rather than a small country like Denmark.
Which, again, which side would it be on? As in,
the thing that we've discussed so far is that we would define them a new faction as a minor faction and link it to a current major faction until it has, so you say, like enough equipment and army branches that it can actually stand on its own. And I think actually that would be a good way to start introducing new stuff, because then we don't have to like build an entire faction and then risk that it's nobody wants to play it.
Right, exactly. But I'm just thinking, for example, if you added Denmark, for example,
yeah,
which faction would it be matched with? Is it Germany or the Allies?
It would. Denmark would. I know that a lot of Danes would probably hate me for saying this, but it would probably be matched with the German faction. Yeah. Simply because it was, it's.
I mean, the Allies considered Denmark an enemy until very late. So
yeah.
It's kind of funny that, I mean, some people are saying, "Oh, you're German. You're biased against the Germans because you're still mad about the war." I'm
like, no, I think that was it's interesting history. I think the first 3 years, the Danish government collaborated with the German government until the.
You know, basically saying, let's keep everybody
quiet. They were just like, we'll sort of like go along to make sure that nobody gets
Beat killed. Up for nothing.
Yeah.
So, so because it'd be weird to see like the German army, the Danish army with its own hats and its own equipment.
We actually had a few of our own, like in Massen. It's a production of machine guns and submachine guns.
Which was okay. It was an okay machine.
They're really good. Especially the I think the bolt action rifles were actually very, very good.
Mm.
So we could add some of our own stuff, though. No tanks, though.
No, but that's the thing, right? In Nien April, in the movie, the 9th of April, it's actually a good one if you want to see what Denmark looked like during the war. The guys were on bicycles with... you got static.
Yes.
But yeah, they were basically on bicycles machine guns.
Like
I think one guy had the bipod and the other guy had the machine gun.
Bicycle was used a lot at the time. It's much cheaper than having a horse. So didn't need food.
It's a tradition.
Only a little bit of oil and some air in the tires.
All right, moving on, because we got so many more. Patton 97, when will shotguns be added to the game? It's not even if, it's...
When?
Hmm.
Let's see if I can come up with a clever answer for that one.
When the farmer has had enough of people walking around on his fields?
When Reto.Lito makes a good system for it. That's when we are going to put in the shotguns.
Now we're going to add a link to send spam to Reto.Lito.
Yeah, but you have to choose shotguns or bipods.
Yeah, that's true. It's only one or the other. Next question is
A re-raider.
Okay. He's re-raiding.
It's a raider that comes back.
Like, oh no, not again!
Raid some more. Oh fuck, a re-raider. There he is again.
There's nothing left to plunder. I don't care.
I'm gonna re-raid you.
You said you like the idea of having an equipment depot where every soldier stores his gear, so you can switch your equipment between soldiers. When are you planning to implement this?
I love that idea.
Thursday.
Yeah, I think, again, this is one of those things that we're currently super booked with the vehicle update. So after that sometime, if we can agree on that it's a good idea, I'd say...
All right.
It does solve a lot of our problems. Usually, like we have now with the complicated UI for selecting or buying a gun for your soldier, you have to select the soldier as well and stuff. If you had the depot, you could just go straight and say, "I want this gun."
Mm.
And even if you don't have any soldiers who can use it yet, you can still have it.
Mm.
So,
yeah, less headache for everybody.
It also we have our bundle systems and giveaways and stuff like that. We could actually just say, "Yeah, have this weapon, boom," and then it's just in your depot. Then and we don't have to worry about if the player have a soldier that can use it. So lots of annoying problems will be solved with the with the depot slash garage slash what do you call it, an airfield
type. Storage.
Yeah.
Yeah. So hangar.
Hangar, yeah, yes, there is. That was the word on the,
lager.
You have to take this away from me.
Yeah. I can't put any of that in my mouth. I have to read questions. You want a Twizzler?
That'd be good.
What was I going to say? Roop. Next question is from Opposing Forces. Can we get the ability to report player names, equipment names, squad names? I've seen a lot of racist names or references to the Nazis and other hate groups or slogans. Will you have the ability? In the game, you can if you right-click the scoreboard, then you can click on a player's name and report him. I think the categories in the little drop-down menu are a little bit vague. Is it like harassment or racism? I forgot what it's specifically labeled, but you can definitely report them under that. You can also send a ticket to me.
Because you get a lot of tickets.
We try to tweak the name filter also, so we get less of those. When there's a name that keeps coming back, public service announcement is not okay to use any kind of reference to hate groups, war criminals, all of that. Yeah. If anything that has to do with like specifically you guys, specifically, we're not supposed to be born, we're going to kill you, that's not okay in our game. The idea that like you're not the right color to play the game is not okay in our game. Everybody's welcome. You can't target people like that. So otherwise, you know, historical, fine. Just, you know, within certain limits. So if it's something that hurts right now in the news, I mean, there's a lot of violence in the real world, that stays in the real world. Our game is a game. That's generally speaking. So yeah,
it's a nice and peaceful game.
And end of breach. But yeah, you can definitely report that in game or with tickets. So your next one is General Rush One. He's asking, if German overpopulation is a problem, why not put a cap limit? And cap, I guess he means capacity. Mm-hmm. Capacity limit to join the war. People who fight on the German side will always do so if you give them the option to choose. Everyone wants a fair and well-balanced war, but it's impossible if one faction has double the players. It's the German invasions sometimes. So you get insane ATQs, you get 18 versus 12 battles. He says the underdog bonus is not working as intended and you have to try other ways to fix the problem. My solution is to implement a gradual cap system that can increase if all three factions have the same amount of players. Let's say the limit is 1,000 players and Germany already reached the limit. So the only valid option is to join the war on the US or Soviet side until each faction has 1,000 players, then the limit will be 2,000 and so on. I already know what you're going to say to that, but let's see if I'm right.
No, but he's actually, if I understand it correctly, suggesting to have a cap that moves with the... So it keeps the imbalance, or keeps the balance if the 10 players are... So it sort of like it locks the faction with the most players. So you cannot join that at all and until the two other factions have been... has been fully booked.
So what are people going to do when they reach the cap, that limit?
Suggestion is that that they would probably play the other faction, but they might not. They might actually just leave the game instead.
Or they're going to use an alt account on the other faction so that they can log in on the first one.
Yeah, and
I think that's what's going to happen. Actually, but we had similar problems when we didn't have the underdog thing going on. We've had various periods in development, I think, where people were just... for example, there was a limit in how many assault teams you could deploy.
Yeah.
So what they did is just, well, I'm going to have two accounts then.
Yes. You know, and the multi-account thing is really hard to. You can't really limit that on a PC free-to-play game. You can do all sorts of mechanics like this on a mobile game, for example. That's usually where the similarities stop. Is that on a PC? On a mobile games, it's very easy to lock you to the specific game, so you cannot start up the mobile game on several different accounts. At least it's very hard to do because you have to switch, for example, link to different Facebook accounts or stuff like that. Game center on the iMac, you have to make several accounts in another system. So that can quickly become very
tedious
to do. But on the PC, it's very easy to do. So that's kind of like the multi-account stuff is what really makes it difficult. Also because you could say that just to free up place on players on your, say you put the hard cap or the soft moving cap on the German side, mm-hmm. you have a lot of players who will then as you say make several accounts on the other sides and just start joining those so they can join the German
and they wouldn't be playing, they would just be empty accounts.
And what can we do when the moving thing also have because the amount of active players obviously varies with the time of the day and where on earth we're situated, so it goes up and down all the time. Which means should the lock then come down as well, or should it because some it's I'm not really sure that it's I think this solution has actually been discussed. What we obviously try and do instead is instead of making a hard cap or hard lock, we start to give incentives to sort of like lure players to join the other side. I think the bonuses they actually work. But they don't work good enough. Mm-hmm. So it's not like a black and white thing where it doesn't work at all. It actually works. It's just there's so many players who want to play the German side that it's ridiculous. And if you give them a reward for playing the other side, you also sort of like know that they will play the other side. Doesn't make sense to have a reward for not playing. So that's why it's bonuses for being active. But it's something that we continuously would have to look into how we can solve this. I have a maybe it would be better when we have more factions. I'm not sure if that will solve it, but I know for sure that it's not a problem. It's not something that we can definitely solve forever. We also had at one point we put in hard limits, so you couldn't join I think there was like up to 1,000 players or something. When 1,000 players had joined one faction, you would have to join another war. So we had several wars in parallel, but that just split up the player groups. Usually, you would like to play together with a few friends. So it's just super annoying that you can't play. You're the one that didn't get in.
Yeah,
that's just okay. See you tomorrow, guys.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm happy that that you guys out there keep coming up with new suggestions of how to maybe solve this problem. So it's not that I'm totally refusing to do anything about it. It's just something that's kind of hard to solve. So, but again, this is a somewhat good discussion, and
yeah, it's in the right direction. I
guess. It is in the right direction because it has this soft, and we might. Have a little design discussion later to see if it actually has, if it can be used for anything.
Thank you for that. Because I didn't want to come off as too sarcastic. I mean, it's just, sometimes it sounds like, why don't you just, well.
it's not that we don't discuss these things, but some of the problems that actually have several, like.
Layers.
Yeah.
Of the, complexity. Yeah. Next guy then, Zwizzler. Is asking is two standard combat badges a possibility instead of one?
It is definitely a possibility. We might actually do that, open it up at some point. I think right now it's we need to put in a lot more combat badges, I'd say. Because there's some classes where you basically only need one, or you only need two. So you just have like this is just your standard setup of combat badges, and having only veterans have the option to choose two would force you to think a little bit more about what you're gonna do, which one you're gonna use. When we have enough combat badges in each class that says you can. There's no sort of like a cookie cutter type thing where you just it has to be this and this, and
the choice is obvious.
Then we can start to look into opening up this, so it will be more like a you have to choose which combination is fitting your current play style or what you plan to do with this soldier.
So. Yes. Next one is from a certain Captain Benji. What changes are you planning to make to the game easier for new players to understand and not instantly get slaughtered by a dude with an STG and 1,000 hours of gameplay.
We are actually currently going through again what is like the first user flow in the game to see where we can put in, or if we can do some changes that makes the like the core mechanics more easily understandable. Mm. And also there's a thing about the end goal of the game, which is currently not very visible for new players. A lot of our players actually don't know that they can play a role in the war. You see it as a first-person shooter, they come in and they play, and they don't even know that there's a strategic layer to the game. So we would actually like to bring that stuff to the front of the game, if you could say it like that. Mm-hmm. Also, we have been discussing making some very, very short videos on base mechanics that new players will see. Okay, you have to capture like this. This is how capturing works, or this is how changing your weapon works. Simple stuff because
the winning conditions could be a little bit more visible. Yeah, definitely.
Exactly.
Because that's a recurring thing. I think that players, the new players, don't quite know where they're supposed to go. What's more important than what?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, yeah.
But we do also have the bots in the first. I don't know if Captain Benji is aware of this, because some of our really old players might not have played the. As a new player, you will actually face bots in the first few matches, and we're still like building on that system. We might actually extend it some more. So the first few matches, you will not be killed by a 1,000k hour dude, because you will be playing against bots. And those, and we can set them to be super easy to kill, so you can just the controls at least before you start to meet other players. Mm.
That's some feedback we got a lot from the insiders while they were here.
Yeah,
they were talking about the UI a lot, and Reto Odin got a lot of feedback directly from them about like this is not clear, this is not obvious, this should be more visible, all that.
Yeah, so it was very, very good for us to be able to sit down with those guys and discuss details. Mm.
Next one is from Devanor. Can the paraplane pilot AI be replaced by a player or be improved?
Oh yeah.
I would love to improved or replaced.
I think it's because I think a lot of the more veteran players they already know or like they can predict the pattern of the plane, and that's why it's for them it's easy to shoot it down, which can become very annoying. I've been suggesting that for a few times that we could at least have the option for pilots to join in as the pilot of the paratrooper plane, but. The argument against that I usually get when I suggest it is that then you have a lot of players who will just grief all the time, just join in and just crash the plane all the time, make it super annoying.
Or hijack it to
something. So. But again, that could probably be. We would probably have to have some sort of like a system tied to the squad, similar. We can say like this: our pilot is an asshole. Kick him.
but I'm thinking also if you're there, you could have a limit, as in you need to be at least level something pilot to be able to fly the paraplane.
It will also give the pilot something else to do, actually.
Yeah,
which could be fun. Yeah. I think the being able to control the paratrooper plane would be a huge advantage for the paratroopers. So it's I will not stop suggesting it anytime soon.
It's got two edges. I'm not sure myself.
A lot of players might just find it super boring, but I think some players might find it interesting.
Yeah. Right. Next one then. Valakarix is asking, will you add portable mortars or heavy artillery for soldiers? Portable heavy artillery, or for a new class? We get that a lot.
Yeah. Mortars are sort of like in the same, like the small mortars are in the same category as the shotguns. Mm. We need some good mechanics, and it's not that we could just look at other games how they do it. We don't have time to do it yet because we have other stuff that the guys that are supposed to be doing that kind of mechanics are working on. So I think that would be nice to have. Mortars. We need to make sure that it's not too easy to just like spam everything with the mortar grenades. Heavy artillery is something very different because we can't really use heavy artillery in the levels we have or the maps we have now because they're simply too small. Heavy artillery is really long range, but I can definitely see them as being part of the strategic game, where you can place, if you can move your heavy artillery assault team close enough to the front line, maybe you will be able to fire barrages or something, as to just simply
kill off resources.
Yeah, just kill off resources. Yeah. It wouldn't be nice to have some the guys not on the receiving end might think it's nice to see your enemies getting blown out by huge explosions. But a simple thing would be actually just say there's an artillery strike and then just remove some resources from from the enemy team's resource pool. So I think that's how we would eventually implement heavy artillery like that.
I would feel we also, I mean, in the action game, that you have a heavy artillery and no apparent damage to the structure.
Yeah, but usually say that I think battleships have a role in the game as well, at least as heavy artillery, moving it up the coastline and just killing enemy resources would be at least play a role in the game, rather than obviously I think it would be difficult to have a game where you have like 20 sailors controlling a huge ship. That would probably be a different game, but on the strategic side of just viewing it as artillery might be cool.
Next question then, Superbot 3010 is asking, is there going to be a new map? I'm boring. No, you're not boring. You're bored playing on the same maps. Also, is there going to be some new vehicles or not? Well, I guess we answered that.
Yeah.
Just rewind. Yeah. Let's move on to the next question because we already mentioned the new maps and everything.
Did we?
Yeah. We mentioned that the Soviet maps are being worked on. And
But we can say that there's a new map on the.
Oh, that's true. On prototype.
On the prototype, right?
Log on to prototype.
We still have. Yeah, obviously, as usual, we started to take a lot of our stuff apart, and we're still working on some of the new tech for the new maps. So instead of just saying once again that because the Russian maps, at least two of them are from a level design perspective, you can say like nearly done. Mm. Desi has done a great work of actually making the maps, and we played them a few times.
Yeah, that's true.
Just with placeholder graphics, and now we are updating the terrain and the graphics has to look nicer and stuff. Mm. So that we're in more in the art production type phase of those maps. And while we are doing this, Desi has made another map for release for this, for the 1010 or for the 110 update, which is a simple encounter map, another encounter map. But the design and layout is different than the depot map, where he's opted for a much larger capturing zone with some houses and little village and stuff. It plays differently. That has been the focus. Let's try and make at least one map in different scenario that uses the same game mode but have very different parameters, because then we can start to measure which one are the most fun game of map to actually play and learn from that. It will be rotated in the for new players as well, so it works with the bots as well. I think you can on the prototype. I'm not sure if everybody starts out as with a fresh account.
That's a good question.
Yeah.
But if you do start out with a fresh account on prototype, then you can try the map with bots.
Yeah.
And we're actually interested to know if the bots are too aggressive. or
yeah.
No, but they were kind of surprisingly good at defending that village.
Yeah. And it has been running on the map has been, we have been making a few public tests.
On prototype.
Yeah. Yeah.
No. When the insiders were there, they got to see it first.
But we actually, we already looked at some of the heat maps and the data for it.
That's true.
Made a few minor changes for the update. So there is at least a tiny new map coming along.
Right. Next one is Merlin. Why don't you add more random buildings somewhere on the map? Like, it makes no sense how there are buildings only near the objectives. Can you add more random buildings? Because the map feels empty. Which map? Well, I guess, yes, some of the maps do.
Some of the maps could use a little bit more buildings. We have actually made somewhat of an active choice of not having too many buildings around the map, simply because it's easier for you to recognize that this is an important space. And if you start to just clutter everything with houses, and I'm not saying that he's suggesting that we should have houses all over, but if we do it, it makes it harder to figure out or instantly see where is the important part of the map, where is the capturing zone. But we are adding small sheds and like smaller houses or smaller buildings around the map, and also we could add some ruins and stuff, something that's not tied to a capturing zone.
10 minutes.
We'll go to chat.
But again, is it the Liv Cafe?
That's the previous question. It's Merlin who was asking.
Oh, Merlin, yeah. Go to the forums and check out on some of the threads where some of the map designs are discussed, and make your suggestions there, because those guys that are in those threads are usually well known of the maps. And so I know that Deshi usually reads those forum threads and tries to pick out some of the better suggestions and incorporating into his updates of the maps. So check the forums.
I guess LV is from Latvia, anyway, LV Kefia, 2016 is asking, would it be possible to make custom paths for assault teams? Because in many cases, assault teams tend to take a path that are in a war zone, where there's a battle in the path.
Yeah.
So if players could make custom paths for their assault teams, the war would go smoother and or smother, as you wrote, and it would be less worrying for generals. So he's basically talking about adding waypoints, I guess, right, to the...
Yes, it has again been discussed. I think the current issue with the adding waypoints is that it doesn't solve that much, because it takes a long time for the if you plan to go around something and not in a straight line, it's a much longer route, and the war actually changes quite a lot. So that route you point out might very quickly or at some point be broken, and then your assault team is just stuck in another place that where is a battle. So it doesn't really do much unless you plan to have like a huge traveling around. But then again, you could probably do it in a few.
It depends how much, I guess, you micromanage.
It's also an extra thing for the server to keep track of, like a cache of points, rather than right now every assault team that's in movement only have a destination, and that's it. And if everybody had like two or three destinations, it's two or three times the amount of data that needs to be held on the server. Not that should be a problem as such, but it takes a little bit more time to actually do a feature like that.
But that has it's been suggested before. So next is from Zolniersz. Poland 123, I assume. Can you add more vehicles and tanks? Wait, I heard that before. could you add modifications to the car? For example, take off a rifle or mount a roof. I guess remove the MG and have a roof instead. Or I guess that's what it means by So modifiable vehicles. Is that something that is possible?
Not with our that type of modification is not really possible with the current system we have for the vehicles. And you could argue that almost all of the vehicles could have an MG mount on top of it, and you could choose to put an MG there or not. And then there's the other question. In the question is can you add more vehicles and tanks? And we are actually working on several new vehicles, but we have chosen to hold them back until we get maps and an armor update or vehicle update out there. We might actually release some of them together with the vehicle update. just because it makes sense to have more vehicle classes with the new system.
Another one. We still have some, what, 5 minutes? Banana Gamer 007 is asking.
I just love all those game attacks. They're fucking awesome. People should be named these names in real life.
Yes.
I'll now baptize you, Banana Gamer 007.
Yes. will you add in Heroes and Generals warships? No, sorry. Will you add warships in Heroes and Generals and
a battlefield with islands? I think I already sort of like said that before with the warships, and I've actually been thinking of quite a bit of this that Reto.Oxen and I have actually been playing quite a lot of World of Warships. Mm. And I kind of like that kind of gameplay, like long-range gunnery type thing. Mm. What I don't really like is this, the maps are a bit weird. It's, it's out in the open ocean where there's suddenly a cluster of islands. That's a bit strange. Mm. And then it's a bit too sort of like, I would like to actually slow it down a little bit more to have more fewer battleships and more control of them or something like that. But I'd say that that just requires a whole new... almost a whole new game, but it's definitely, if you could come up with something that would work well, it would be nice. One thing about warships is that they are insanely detailed.
Yeah.
I don't know if you saw a video at one point where one of the artists from Wargaming just demonstrated how they built the ships for World of Warships. And it's like, I think it was almost like almost a year of one man year it takes to build one of those big ships. So it takes forever, and as if you look at them, there's a ton of details on it. And if I say that I would probably have fewer ships, but then you could also imagine that, then they're going to be more detailed. Gonna have if more players should be able to control the same ship or the guns on the ship or something like that, then you just need a lot more details. You can almost like look at it as the entire ship would be one map in itself. So it's not easy. Warships, battleships especially, are, that's also why they're so goddamn expensive to produce in real life, is that they are massive and complicated things. But I would obviously like to love it if it was possible to have an action game in Heroes and Generals with the battleships. But on the other hand, I think it fits perfectly the like the heavy artillery type thing if it's only in a strategic game. So. Long answer to a short question again.
Yes. next question then. Tainted Shroom. Why hasn't the Soviet paratrooper received a class-specific weapon?
Because we are German biased.
wait, where's my? It's too late now.
Sorry, you will get your paratrooper weapon at some point in time. When we get to that, we're still working on the vehicle stuff.
Yes.
I think if I remember correctly, the part of the forum with the reference regiment that Cristiano is leading, they actually have come up with a few very good suggestions for Russian paratrooper weapons that could be added. So it's actually not because we lack some weapons to put in. I think there's some great suggestions out there. It's just a matter of us picking, or even the forum saying this is the right one to add. You should do this instead of this. So,
yes. We have time for one last forum question, I guess. Kilroy115 is asking, has there been any discussion on the addition of anti-tank guns being added? That's a lot of adding into the game at some point into the future, such as the 88, well, it's not flak if it's anti-tank, it would be the PAK 36 and the 3-inch M5.
Yes, I think I actually mentioned it. Did I mention it last time or the time before?
I think you mentioned it. Yeah.
About the. I would like to implement them in the same way as the anti-aircraft guns that are placed on the maps, but a little bit differently in that. I could actually see this going into the resource system on the strategic map, so you have an anti-tank anti-tank infantry type assault team would provide resources for respawning heavy guns or anti-tank guns in certain positions on the map.
And they would be at a specific spot.
Yeah, right? We just need to figure out how are those guns, for example, would it be a player having to spawn on that position and the gun appears? Or how do we do it?
And how do you make them move? Like, do you have bots actually pushing them around?
No, they should be in fixed positions.
And they're fixed positions,
fixed
right?
positions, you wouldn't be able to move them around.
Even rotate?
No, the gun actually traverses a little bit.
It traverses a little bit, okay.
So it'll more be a work for Deshi to actually clutter all the maps with good positions for placing those guns, so there would be enough so the tankers wouldn't instantly know where they are. The same with the anti-aircraft guns. Basically, you would because at the moment we have a bit of an unbalanced thing with the anti-aircraft guns. If you look at them, the Russian and the Germans are completely different weapons. There's a huge range in calibers, it would be nice that the Russians could also get a 20 millimeter and the Germans would have like an MG type A gun.
Did they have one, the Russians, 20 millimeter?
I think it was only the Americans that are just really loved their 50 cal.
Okay.
But I think it would be cool if it was the player's choice to deploy which type of AA gun or anti-tank gun, because it's, in my view, it's sort of like the same thing. It's a big fixed gun that fits somewhere on the map, but I just needed to be tied up to the resource system in the strategic game as well. So I think it would be something that's good it's something that we definitely have been discussing. It's some of those weapons that are played a huge role in the war, and they're hard to fit into a game without everybody thinking, yeah, I should be able to push it around and stuff like that. And it's kind of like it quickly becomes very, very cumbersome to have a system. So I would actually rather have the level designer prepare a lot of fixed positions where they fit.
Right, chat questions now. I guess we'll. I have the chat open somewhere. But it's white. I guess I'll make it black. Oh, not this.
Just take it from the screen.
Dark mode. Roop.
It's on the screen.
Ah, yeah. Oh, beautiful. Where's the? It's your show.
All right. Let's see what Mr. Vacuum Cleaner is saying.
Mr. Vacuum Cleaner. That's my new favorite name.
Since the US were getting the British pilot with the Spitfire, can the Germans get a Japanese pilot with the iconic A6M0? That's exactly what I'm talking about, that it would be easier for us to actually add some of those things into the game if we go the path of just specific class, one vehicle, when we introduce a new factions rather than a complete faction. Because this question might actually just lead me to make the decision on this one. Ibsen, Klaus Ibsen.
Where do you see that?
Ibsen. C. Ibsen is saying it's 1,000 rounds per minute and 693 rounds per minute better than 579 rounds per minute.
Is it a math question?
No, not necessarily, I could say. Depends on the weapon and stability and everything else that plays into this. If the question goes on in the lines of it's a faster shooting weapon better than a slower one, it's actually only valid for fixed guns that are tied to something really, really heavy. Then you might have an advantage of a faster shooting weapon.
I still can't get the highlight thing to work.
You see,
it's called Icureuil.
I said that just really slow.
Yeah, and Grøn Aeon.
In what?
Grønne æren.
Oh, the green squirrel.
Green squirrel.
When can we buy H&G accessories? Well, you can actually now. You can buy them by sending tons of candy for Splixen. Maybe I should actually change that to if you send us like a specialty beer from your country that you think is really good, yes, that might also...
Unless you're Italian, then you send wine.
Yeah, I have to wrestle Splixen because he's going to steal some hoodies from him then. Not all of us eat tons of candy, only Splixen.
There's Hit and Run 2016 asking you, how long do I put my potato in the microwave? He's watching a different show, I think.
That depends on what
you're making.
Yeah, but both your potato and your microwave, yes. I'd say. It's a fine balance.
Right.
There's Hawks saying, add notice to friendly stealing APCs. They make APCs invalid. Yeah, maybe we should just get a block on that so we can't steal a friendly APC.
Oh yeah, when the guy's too far away, suddenly it becomes possible to steal.
Yeah, but also you usually place the APCs for others to use, so friendlies messing around with them is not the intention.
There's a good one here. Velacarix is asking, could you possibly add the ability to shoot while jumping, or maybe while parachuting?
Parachuting, yes. While jumping, no. I think that would be, we deliberately didn't do that simply because we don't want to have you should not have too many advantages of jumping. So that's a pure like balancing decision.
Yeah.
I know that half the world will disagree and the other half will say yeah, but that's kind of like
the... Remember the old trailer where the British officer jumping?
Yeah. You can't
that's
do
probably
that.
Where that comes from.
Yeah. It's
not our fault.
it's a good old discussion. So that's a no and maybe.
Yeah.
Because I think we, in the beginning, we had the game, we had the possibility to shoot from in the parachuting. Mm. And it's actually it's pretty fun, and it's okay because when you are hanging up there, you're really exposed. Let me see if I can find another one here.
The one right below. How about that?
I haven't found it, so I just answered you. Oh, let's see. Ape Men saying, will we ever see flamethrowers for infantry, and when can we expect the ME-262 for the Germans? And what will this be the Soviet and US counterpart? That's a lot of questions all thrown into one. Flamethrowers. I think some of the insiders might have a little bit of info on those flamethrowers. But it's hard to see how they can, how we should actually incorporate them into the game without being either useless or super annoying. I think they are, there's kind of like those binary things as either super useless or just too powerful, simply torching everybody. Would also like we should at least have some friendly fire so you can run around and burn all your friends. I think that it's just difficult to figure out how to exactly to implement them without either make them annoyingly good or
just
irrelevant. Yeah. And the ME-626, I think I read, wasn't there a question at some point about the top speed of those different planes and the how that some guy told me that it wasn't really that fast as everybody thinks. But it depends on what kind of where you look at the numbers. It is actually very fast, and it is much faster than the American and British counterparts. Obviously, you could say that we could. There was jet fighters from the other factions. They just wasn't put into production for various reasons. So we could make the jump into saying, "Yeah, we're just going to add some of those prototype jets." Or we could just make it, because again, I think the thing with the ME-262 is that it's probably not all an advantage to have a really fast plane, simply because it gets very hard to aim or shoot anything with it. So it might be the same mechanic as Like the fast firing guns that are actually not the best simply because they are uncontrollable.
In the current game mode, I guess also you'll just fly out of the map very quickly.
So I think we'll probably just add this one first and then see how it goes, and maybe have a few tests and see if we should do something with some other planes that are also very fast, or if we just leave it as being this is a special German plane that catches fire really easily.
you got a few interesting ones.
There's a Kerberos 209 saying, any update on balancing the heavy fighters? Nope. Cristiano is thinking about it, I think. So that's all I can say about that one.
There was a guy up there just above Ape Man. He was asking about his name is Ziki. How about adding a hardcore mode, like in Battlefield 1 or competitive mode?
Yeah. So yeah, we have been talking about using the level system for having special matches. So you have to be a certain player level in order to gain access to like special matches. K-Smith is asking, can you make the deploy free with resource instant at the start of the war, meaning no deploy queue at the start of a war? Some people can't be online at the end of a war and then they can't deploy at all. I see the problem here is that you have you're in the deploy queue and the war ends and you've been sitting there for 2 days and and when you log on, there's a new queue. You're still gonna wait. We did think about if it was possible to transfer the queue between wars, but it makes it problematic in where you're supposed to deploy, or can this be exploited with multiple accounts and stuff like that. But I think it's at least worth thinking about the whole. If you are almost about to deploy your assault teams and the war ends, then you have to, then we just keep the deploy queue. Or at least you can make an option of saying I want to carry over to the next war, because some players also they wait with some of the deployments for later and stuff like that. So I know it's a problem that it's really hard to know when the war ends and to be able to be first in line for the next one. That was a very non-answering answer I just came up with there. Sorry about that. Are there Titan of Wars asking, are there super heavy tanks planned like the Maus or the T-95? They're not really planned, but I think that they, I must say again, I think they have some sort of like a place in the game. You just need to figure out a way to like severely limit their use.
Or the Rote.
Yeah.
It should be its own level.
Yeah, that
it should
be. It
doesn't move, you move in it.
Yeah, exactly. It's like a battleship that's on land. Add a filter so new players can choose to play versus veterans instead of wait 30 minutes to find a match. Yeah, at some point we do need to look at a little bit at the system we used to for the matchmaking and make it an option for players to actually force themselves to be bumped up and say, yeah, I just want to play, so I don't care if I'm going to be matched in with a professional clan or whatever, veteran clan.
No, there's one asking about the paraplanes. Mosul Römer is asking, Have you ever thought about spawning paraplanes much higher than fighter planes and add some clouds so that the paraplanes are more difficult to spot?
So they're out of reach from the AA guns? No, I don't think we actually did that. I think it's the problem is that it gets really hard to see
where you're going.
Yeah, yeah. Because you just have, but it's definitely something that
yeah, because if you jump above the clouds, yeah, that's true. You're not going to see anything. So you don't know
but
when you're
close.
It would
be fun to try at least, so you just jump out and you. But then again, and the paratrooper will just be in the air for a lot longer.
Yeah, that's the first thing that popped to mind is like how long is it going to take to even reach the ground? And I think that's pretty much why it's fun to have them low.
But it's a fun suggestion.
Let's do 5 minutes.
Right.
5 minutes.
Awkward silence.
Sorry, I'm reading.
We're reading.
What is this? Echelon is asking, with the new spawn system and weapons being available to all classes, how will the mods for the weapons be handled? You could have two different soldiers able to use the weapon in battle, but one has the ribbon maxed, so can use all the mods, and the other, what will happen then? I'm not sure that, maybe this is mixing a little bit of two different things. Obviously, the new deploy system does not allow you to swap weapons between soldiers, but it does allow you to an easier way to swap soldiers in and out of the battle. It might be referring to the depot, where you can have a fully modded rifle in the depot, and you have you want to use it with a soldier that doesn't have the unlocks for it yet. I would simply put in a warning saying this weapon have mods that are not your soldier cannot yet use. Right. And just take them off, simply.
Right. Because you're talking about dynamically switching weapons while you're in the battle.
Yeah.
Or something like that. Okay.
So I think that's that's what he means, I think.
Right.
MG Gamer 1209 is saying, will there be any new game modes added? Game modes, you can say that it might be a little bit of a stretch to call the tank game mode entirely new game mode, because the actual rules are somewhat similar to the encounter, except that it's mixed bots. So you could call it a new game mode, the tank stuff, where you have both tanks on the player controlled tanks on both sides, and you have bots on both sides, infantry bots on both sides that are trying to take the point. So that is at least something that looks like that sounds a little bit like a new game mode.
Oh, there's a guy called Kez asking. Well, he's not asking; he's telling. Bring back more fog. check out prototype. There's three new kinds of fog. Two new kinds of fog.
Yeah,
really.
There's new weather settings as well.
Yeah,
pretty ones.
Okay, well, spoiler. Yeah, the new weather settings are actually that's the part I'm most excited about. I can't wait to play the various games on.
In the beginning, you showed the changelog.
Yeah, so it's in there in the changelog. But so spoiler, there was how many were missing? Five.
Yes.
Yeah, because we have a whole matrix of weather settings. There's four times of day. And three possible weather conditions. So you have basically dawn, day, sunset, night, and then you have clear, foggy, and overcast. Yeah. And there were some of them that were missing in the Matrix. So now we have, for example, Foggy Dawn, Overcast Dawn, Foggy Night. Foggy Night was there, but Overcast Night is awesome. Ezra is my favorite. It's like just before dawn, and you see like a pink line of like just daylight that at the horizon. It looks really dramatic. It's awesome.
Soul Horror is asking, will you allow a higher ranked player in the squad to be automatically appointed as a squad leader, or allow the auxiliary seat to be used at least? A few streams ago, we talked a little bit about our designs for an updated deploy system that actually involves a change of the auxiliary seats. So this would not be used or needed in a new system, I guess. All right, are we done for today?
I guess we could call it. That was a long 5 minutes. You want to do something?
Let's take one more question.
Yes. And then. Did we already answer that one? Uli's.
Maybe. I don't know.
They probably didn't hear that question.
It's Doc 8 Faces asking, are you going to send veteran code on Black Friday? I think the PR guys are planning something for Black Friday.
Yeah, actually, I think I might have heard something.
So, and then there's the Andy Canarius is asking, any chance to add the Fucker Wolf 190 in the future? Never. But you don't want more planes, I've heard. Yeah. You have to show the sign again.
Yes. It's almost 5 p.m.
All right, let's wrap this up.
Yes. You didn't want to answer the last one?
What last one? I can't see your screen.
Uli 712 is asking ranks on uniforms.
Once in a while, that question actually comes up. It's super hard to make it. It would require quite a lot of work to actually make it, and it's kind of like not really useful. Mm.
It's a small return for a lot of work.
It's more like a vanity type thing rather than something that's useful in the game.
I could see if you had a kind of gallery view where you see, like, before you get into combat, you see your character in like a high res model, then you would put that on there, right?
Yeah. But so far, with a better decal system, it would be possible to do it. But
all right then, let's call it a day. And thanks for all the questions.
Yes, thank you for the questions.
They were actually very interesting. Today we talked about some news about the recent Insider Summit and also the current playtest that's going on Prototype. You can rewind to see what that's all about. And then for the rest of the show, we've been taking forum questions and questions from the live chat. I'm starting to come down with something, I think. If you missed the beginning, you can watch this show on YouTube later on, and you can follow this right there, which is apparently a button to follow the Twitch channel. You can also find us on Facebook, on Twitter, YouTube, and of course on our own website, heroesandgenerals.com. You can find a new questions thread on the news site and on the forums in the news and updates section. And remember, only one question per player. Now there's a lot more people asking questions. So if you want basically one of your questions to have a chance to make it through one question per player, is also for your sake. Check in next Wednesday. There will be a community frontline with Reto Circinus, but it's at a different time next week. It's going to be at 4 p.m. Central European time. So next Wednesday with Reto Circinus. In the meantime, we're going to wish you a great week. See you in game.
Yeah.
And remember to have fun.
And be nice.
And be nice.
Be nice.